How to be there, they create an immersive experience of limitations, and how you how you bring it to the here and now. And that because for us it's not history. History is not history. It's not in books, pages, and you know, iconography and everything. It's just, no, it's here and now. And what we had is a feeling that Auschwitz and the concentration camps and extermination camps were in fact something. For a human being, that was our assumption, in a sense, extremely normal. You know, the experience of it was, it's not what you see in films, you know, the big mythical thing. You arrive in a place and things happen to you as you walk out in the street. It happens that only that in a concentration camp, you don't know what's going on, what will happen in the next minute.
Did you put yourselves any limitations from the start? Like, did you define what, not only what you want, first of all, and then define what you definitely don't want?
You did, definitely. It was clear from the start that you wanted to have one single individual, that everything that you would experience in the film was through his eyes, and that you would not see what he does not see. He would not, you know, pay attention to things that were routine for him. That was one of the restraints. The second one is, but that's something you discussed with your DOP. It was not about making a beautiful film, you know, for the sake of sheer aestheticism. And I would say there was maybe a third restraint, which was not to make a historical best of what happened. That was mostly for me, because, you know, I have a history of being a researcher. So at first, you know, there was this temptation of putting backstories for each character, you know, stories I had read in this testimony and that testimony. But that was wrong. That would have made something awful. So.
Yeah, at first versions of the script, you could sense that it was there were a lot of characters talking about the past and bringing in elements from before, as if they had a story. But we understood very quickly that these people have no past. These people have no history. They only have present, and that was very important in defining the logic of the scenes, how we approach the scenes. So already on the script level, the logic of the scenes were established, and that was very important. So because in the scenes you're in the middle of happenings and processes, but also the routine processes, and it was very important to find a way to how do you establish the logic of routine, and also how do you put inside of the routine the story of Saul, and what's possible and what's not possible. So we wanted to know the rules of the game. So-called rules of the game of the crematorium, in order to allow the main character to evolve in that. So not doing something that would, you know, be beyond the possibility of one human being. We wanted to just, you know, he is doing something extraordinary for among the crematorium workers, but at the same time, it's still something that can be done. He's not a superhero. He's not a hero in the sense.
He's not a hero. But Clara, you said that you have this tendency to do a lot of research, and it's obvious that a lot of research went into this film, not only the script, but altogether into the film. Yet, in many ways, you were trying not to become documentary in a sense, or a fictionalized documentary. So where were there your limits and the poetic licenses which you took? How did you avoid becoming too documentary? in spite of the research, I mean, you.
The research was the backbone. No, I think the historical research was the backbone against which we build the fiction. But to us, it was clear from the start that we wanted to tell the story of one man. Actually, it all started with this one sentence I've always been telling the story. That László, in 2010 summer, we were talking in a restaurant, and he said, you know, I've always wanted to make a film that happens in a Sonderkommando. And I said, yeah. And he said, I've been thinking of a story. It would be the story of a man who works in a Sonderkommando. And among the bodies, he recognizes his son. That was the first sentence. It changed a little bit since then. He recognizes his son, and he decides to bury the son, which I thought was fantastic. I said, how do you bury anybody in Auschwitz? You know, this is insane. So, and that sentence was it. It was very clear what we were going to talk about. And so, because we wanted to talk about this one man, we had to place him in this context. So we had to research about it. So that's what we would show, would be as close to the true experience of it as we could. Then, if we did take some liberties, we knew exactly what it was. I don't know whether I'm allowed to talk about one or the other liberty, but if I may say, can I talk about the crematorium? Maybe. No. So the crematorium, basically, that you see is it's on three levels, but it's placed where this three-level crematorium was not. It was in another place. So basically, we use one crematorium that was the structure of crematorium number two, but we use the place of crematorium number four. That's one of the kind. That's. Yeah.
We actually had to.
That's one of the poetic licenses we used.
We had access to these testimonies by the Commando members, these prisoners who were dead in 1944, and but they could write down these notes, and they could actually describe a lot of elements regarding the crematorium and their daily routine and how everything worked, and based on that we had an incredible corpus of information and historical knowledge. But I think you cannot approach anything like that without having this knowledge. You cannot make a film about that. You have to have the confidence of knowing where you navigate. By the way, I think a lot of period films have this problem that the director is not, the makers are not confident in their historical knowledge, so they show the things that have no relevance. They show the production elements of cars and thing and dresses, and so it's constant showing off of what you have and they navigate in very unsure way in this world. So we had to know everything in order to take some liberties. So I, for example, just a very very basic example, I asked for what kind of numbers would a prisoner have? Not all the prisoners in the Sonderkommando would have a number, because there it's as we said, chaos and organization. But I wanted numbers for them that would make sense in 1944 in October in Auschwitz from this country or that country. So we had a list of possible numbers from the historian, and the numbers that pre-existed. We knew that some historical people had these numbers, but we didn't take those numbers. We took other numbers that we made up. So it was, in this sense, a very very detailed work to the very very the smallest details, and it brought us the possibility of being free in this world, in a sense. But actually, what defines what we couldn't cross was the logic of the work of the Sonderkommando and how everything more or less functioned. What time does the Sonderkommando, what occasion he has to take off his cap, for example, you know, when passing a guard. You have to know these things. If you don't know it, you cannot operate. So we had to establish everything around the main character, and then place the main character in this world.
But on the other hand, you did not go for reconstruction. I think you avoided reconstruction in the material, physical sense of the word, I think.
Yeah, we could not do that. And actually, the directorial approach of sticking to him allowed us not to reconstruct everything. Although it's not because I didn't have money that I made this film that way. It's because I made this film that way that I could do it within the restraints of the budget.
Because it was a conscious decision.
It was absolutely
a conscious decision. I hope that what we are talking about, it doesn't sound too kind of.
I hope that everybody saw the film, otherwise it doesn't really make sense, you know, what we're talking about.
When I talk about the basis of historic research, I mean, since I know quite a lot about this subject, and I've watched many materials and read, there are very clear details which are absolutely historic, such as the shot which is attempted from the crematorium, the photos, the famous Auschwitz photos, the Sonderkommando photos, obviously also the revolt, which to many people seem fictional, but it's not. It is really based on fact. So in this sense, you were treading on a safe ground, or at least for yourselves, that you felt you can take the liberties with this material.
Yeah.
Yet, okay, poetic license, you still, okay, you have this one character, you focus on the individual, and you give him a story, you give him a plot.
Yeah, but very, very simple, archaic plot.
Okay.
We knew that we couldn't, even in the logic of the scenes, you know, when in first versions of the script, when he goes to see the woman in Canada, then we used to have some kind of, you know, almost like a romantic scene, and with a few sentences here and there.
Second version killed.
And you know, the girl talking to to Saul, and he's not responding. So it was something a little bit theatrical, but also very, you know, romantic. But then it was evident that we couldn't keep all this you know, superfluous movement in the scene. It just didn't make sense. You know, we were in the middle of a commando sorting out things from, you know, dead people, and it's a factory. You have supervision. Just doesn't make sense in the middle of Auschwitz. It just doesn't make sense. So we had to feel constantly the constraints of this world, constantly the supervision, and where, at what moment you had no supervision, and Saul did not have supervision to either the guards or his own friends or whatever, just to accomplish what he had to do.
So elimination is very much part of the.
Oh yeah. Elimination of superfluous dialogues, of wrong scenes. Yes. No, that's
also,
we're good editors.
Also gestures, you know, gestures,
yes.
and all the way to the shooting. You, it was a process of simplification. You know,
absolutely.
Just the material. You know, was getting rid of the all the superfluous elements, and why would you do that? And you know, I don't even have, you know, very clear examples of that. But he,
well, dance, but for example, hmm? We, you simplified a lot the dance.
Yeah, we simplified everything because we felt, and the DOP was key in that, and the actor was also very helpful in
yes.
In that in this process that, and the DOP especially to keep it as simple as possible. So it was a common work. You know, I was not alone. And Clara was also on the shoot, mm-hmm. And was very, very helpful. And the editor was on the shoot, and it was very helpful. So we had this little crew discussing, you know, all the time the elements and also the language elements. You know, mm-hmm. So it was very much of a common work.
I think elimination in general is part of the process.
Yeah, and also because we knew that we didn't want to do a sort of beautiful film. We had this, and the DOP was very much into that we even wrote down the basic, you know, requirements for ourselves, our approach.
Such as
handheld camera throughout, because we wanted to be as close to the main character as possible. Is a portrait, is a constant portrait of one man, and handheld camera meaning that you're all, you know, continuously you're accompanying. It's like your companion to the main character. You live with him. You feel all the. Can I ask people who are not interested to leave now? And it's very disturbing to have people, you know, going out, you know, like that thing. Just, I don't mind. Just leave now and don't leave after, please. It's very disturbing. Okay, he is Hungarian. I know him. He's excused. He has to leave. All right. Thanks. So, it's good to have tourists, but very, very disturbing. So you know, and the funny thing, we had this handheld camera, and we, it's not, it doesn't look like handheld camera. We were, you know, thinking of Steadicam, but and we went to see the inventor of Steadicam, Garrett Brown, who operated The Shining, and we had it, you know, we talked to him a lot, and he said himself, it's not Steadicam, guys, you're good, it's not, what you want is not Steadicam. We wanted something very steady, like in Come and See, in a sense, but rough. But you're so close to the character, and you're in close focus distance, and at the same time, it's my DOP operated almost the entire shot, and Claudia is not here, no? An entire shoot, and then what the interesting thing was that I, we didn't want it to tremble. You know, when you have handheld camera, you always have this nowadays this trendy constant temptation of making it tremble, which makes me crazy. And I you know, we my DOP and I were very adamant about it. It's not gonna tremble, because human eyes do not function that way. So we accompany the main character. And that was one of the requirements. And when he goes, you know, he's put to the ground, we go with him to the ground, and he goes into the water, we go to the water with him. So it's very organic in the sense. And because we wanted it to be to be on this journey with him, and we had other requirements, such as we used a 40 millimeter lens. We didn't want to change that a lot. We maybe there's one shot with a different focal length. We wanted it to not have film drama. We wrote it down. No film drama. Maybe we have some, but really wanted to reduce this kind of filmic drama. and that we're and what else? These were very important elements. Not to and the light shouldn't be, you know, couldn't be beautiful, and the crematorium inside, and the, you know, in the undressing room, everything was practical in the working place spaces, because we didn't want to do anything else that we knew from the reality of the historical reality. You cannot hide in the sense, even out in the night outside, in the crematorium court, you have this general light on the faces. It's not in the sense, it's not dramatic. You cannot hide in the night, because the human experience of it is not a filmic experience, and we wanted to stick to what we thought was right to convey that.
So I'm trying to put it in a different way, because there are many other elements in the film which support this, I think. It is the ethical decision which dictates the aesthetic decisions, and I would like you to elaborate on that, actually.
Restrain.
Both of you.
I should elaborate on restrain.
I would say something. You want to say something?
No, I think.
Should I?
Yeah. But well,
Okay. Well, we knew that we couldn't. The showing.
Yes.
Is reducing, and that's something also that has to be with cinema, and it's, I think, something that today's filmmakers should be very aware of, that more and more, because of the civilization of imagery, people think that having more is having more, but I think that having more is having less, and having less is having more. So, and I think there's a basic thing in cinema that works, is that you keep a zone of secret and a zone of unknown. That's something that triggers the viewer's imagination much more, and creates imagery inside the viewer's heads. And that's something very important in general in cinema, and I think we're moving away from that in for a civilization of over showing. And the loss of point of view, or maybe a godlike point of view, which is also very problematic, because you cannot identify with godlike point of views. But if for this movie, it was very important to restrain ourselves, because first you cannot show. The assumption being, if you show what took place in the middle of Auschwitz in 1944. You would only reduce it. You would reduce the scope of it. First, you couldn't do it. It would cost too much money. It was a tremendous effort to kill millions of people. So it would cost too much money to recreate that. Sadly, and seriously. But then we wanted to rely on the imagination of the viewer. And the viewer should, that was our willingness, the viewer should feel inside, recreate something that doesn't have boundaries. And how do you achieve that? You achieve that by not showing glass. You use out of focus, you use out of frame, you use sound that's constantly there to suggest there is more. So if the image is restricted, the sound is there to suggest there's much more. So you create a sense of perspective of infinity in the mind of the viewer. That was our aim, at least, to restrain ourselves, because if you reduce the scope of what was going on there, you minimize it, and you make it relative. And for us, it's something that only has echo in the mind, and not in the visual zone. Yeah.
And actually, it's quite interesting to, we had some reactions, of course, and it's fascinating to see how much people project onto the film, invest their own knowledge and their own imagination into what we show.
Well, that's a tricky question, because you rely on common knowledge of the camps and of the extermination and the Nazis and the Jews and everything, but then in the film you have to rely we rely on some preconception assumptions and what's called a common corpus of constructed by 60 years of visual treatment of it, but at the same time you go against it. How do you do that? And so that's something that I don't have really an answer for the moment. I couldn't put words on it. How does it work in the film? I cannot explain. But as I, it came after the film that this idea of you rely on it, but at the same time you go against it. How does it work? I don't know. I have no answer to it, and I don't know to what extent the film achieved in this sense anything. But it's interesting that there's a conflict in it.
So there is a question, perhaps.
Yeah, there's a question maybe to you.
To you, whether without a great corpus of knowledge about the Auschwitz crematoria, Sonderkommando, whether what László was talking about, whether it really came through to you, or you felt that you are lost.
If anybody wants to answer, obviously, but I just wanted to add that obviously all the viewers have preconception of visual preconception and story element kind of preconception or organizational preconception. For example, story meaning this revolt didn't take place. Mm-hmm. It did, but this kind of thing. Or how can he do that? Why isn't he? Why are they better fed, the Sonderkommando? Why don't understand this kind of thing? This is, there are a lot of elements like that. Why isn't it like that in the crematorium? Why are they living in the crematorium? What does it make sense? So this kind of thing, there are a lot of assumptions and why isn't there Nazis, you know, salutes all over the place? Why isn't there a high-ranking general in the crematorium? No, they were like corporals, function. You know, why isn't there more soldiers in the process? Not needed. You know, maybe two soldiers. Maybe they didn't even go into the crematorium. So how do you deal with these issues? It might be interesting, very interesting for me or for historians or people who are interested in that. But how do you convey that in film? How do you how don't you bore your audiences with historical details? And we knew that we didn't want to go into a history film. We were in the middle of things and things that are happening. Mm-hmm. So we had to know again the rules. Yeah,
but I think that's when Saul's story actually is the one thing the viewer relates to. Well, I hope so. It is very archetypal. It is really, that it is said that humanity started when it started to bury its dead. So this is actually what this film is about. It's about coming back to something very archetypal, primal. I don't know. I wouldn't say holy, but something like that.
Yes.
And I believe that's, if the viewer is feeling for Saul, it's because of his quest to actually not kill his son, or who he thinks is his son, a second time, to actually accompany him in death.
How, to what extent it's about the Jews or not, this kind of, usual Holocaust films. Mm-hmm. of those Jews or whatever. And then you, in this film, these are people, in a sense, and you can hardly hear the word Jew. You don't even, maybe some Jew. I mean some insults and things like that. Because sometimes you didn't even know the machine was functioning. You didn't even have to insult anyone. Anyway, so it's not. You don't have to rely constantly on the Nazi art. Things. So it's just people killing other people, and so we wanted to not in an ideological manner, but because we that was the fact, you know, in a sense. But obviously, the Jewish element is there, and very strongly so.
But the question, I mean, we digress now a little bit from the aesthetics, but we'll get back to it. The fact, you know, this rising empathy for Saul via the son, and that's in this dehumanized universe where he lives or where he moves, you add a slight touch of humanity also in his facial expression. Isn't that a concession to make it more digestible to viewers?
I think he does wake up when he sees that boy. It's a wake up. You know, these men were turned into robots. They had to, everything had to be subdued for them because it wasn't, anyway, from the testimonies we read, because we did read some testimonies, not only this collection of manuscripts that were found after the war and that were written by members of the Sonderkommando who died, but also from survivors from the Sonderkommando. There was a book that was published under the title We Wept Without Tears, in which five ancient members of the Sonderkommando actually talk about their routine, their feelings, the lack of social relations that they had. You know, they didn't even know each other's name. They would call each other like you. You know, so that helped us a lot. So we knew how much everything, you know, they became blind and deaf to whatever was happening around them. They were, you know, little bits in the whole machine, in the plant, in the death plant. But in the story, in the film, Saul, you see, it's very important. His eyes are so important in that shot. He sees that boy and he wakes up. Somehow.
What would be the concession?
The concession would be that you did not stay with this harshness, with the total harshness you describe from the testimonies, from those writings, but you give him a little bit of humanity, and so I'm asking.
But it's
and
a
that
story,
makes it for
it's
us.
It's a story of, you know, how it's a story of an internal voice, of an internal survival, or and when there's nothing left, and there's no hope, and there's no God, there's a voice or a God inside. That's the story of the film. That's the spiritual journey of the character.
Okay. This
that,
is what
that is put against in conflict. Against everything that's taking
place. But the
place.
Reality yeah. of the, yeah.
Actually, what's interesting is how he turns his back on the living for his dead.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't play the game of the Sonderkommando anymore. The revolt, absolutely.
The revolt.
Yes, yes.
When we get back now to the film language decisions, so let's call them the aesthetic decisions. You talked about the camera. You have this very specific framing, which is very specific framing on his face. Those are decisions which were born from what consideration?
Well, this is related to what we said about accompanying the being a companion to the main character throughout the film, also to be to concentrate one human being, and we were thinking about using two formats, 2:35 anamorphic, and 1:33 Academy aspect ratio. We shot on film. That was a decision, obviously, from the very beginning. We can talk about it later. That then we wanted to we discovered that anamorphic is very cinematic and is easy on the viewer, but also in this case would bring in too much of the background, and it has beautiful bouquet, which is like the quality of the out of focus. But maybe too beautiful, possibly too beautiful. I will do my next film probably in anamorphic, and I love the format. But the thing is that it gives away too much, and we didn't want to give the background. We didn't want to bring in the background too much. It would have been a spectacular background coming in, and it would have been too much of a trick, cinematic trick. And we came to this decision to restrain the horizontal scope of it, to really to achieve this claustrophobic, very personal, very intimate relationship, and so the viewer can be literally be a prisoner of the frame as much as he, the main character, is a prisoner mm-hmm. of the frame.
And then
what? How do you cut? How do you do that? Because that's something that that we discussed a lot with my editor and the DOP. How do you do that? We could have done. We wanted an immersive experience. We wanted to be in the middle of it. We wanted to be in the process. So how do you do? Do you do 10 minutes? Do you make 10 minute takes? We can do 10 minute takes. It's hard, but it's very sexy. But a little bit too much. And Bela, you know, I worked with Bela Tar. We had great fun, you know, making very complicated shots, and I did short films with very complicated shots. And it's great. I mean, it just creates an electrifying atmosphere, and the actors believe in it, but we didn't want it to indulge ourselves in that. With this film had to be immersive, but the shots should not be. We're not supposed to be beautiful and
no seduction.
No seduction in the choreography of it. So so we had an actor who was an amateur actor. He was
the lead character,
the
right?
The lead character. I'm sorry, you're not an amateur. There's a Mr. Number Two over there. And he was hardly controllable in a sense. So we put on.
He was controllable or not controllable?
He was hardly controllable.
Okay.
So because he's like that. So we put on, you know, the scenes. We put the all the background, what's called the background, which is actually the immersive, you know, all the other members mm-hmm. of the commando, the work processes. We wanted to know that, how it works, so we put on that, and then we put Saul inside of it, and he came after. And then he was harder, so you could design your shots in a way that were designed, but at the same time, everything was so chaotic and hardly controllable in a sense, even if I'm a control freak, it's good, it's just hard to follow the guy, and he would stop at some point. We're not supposed to stop and look that way, and we're not supposed to look. So he was living in a sense, but at the same time it was good because it reflected this mixture of chaos and organization that were in the camp. So again, our basis was how the camp worked, and we worked out of it, and then based on this assumption, and then so we this 2-3-4 minute shots that we have in this film allow us to maintain a continuum, mm-hmm. so this feeling of being there, but at the same time they are like wounded shots in the sense they're not perfect, and they're it's like the experience again of the human experience in the camp. And then we know, Clara mentioned, he doesn't pay attention, main character doesn't pay attention to everything that's like a routine to him. So he's not looking at it. We're not looking at it. Where do you cut? We follow him. So we cut, actually, we find a way to cut. That was the strategy. He looks, every time he looks for a new way to bury the child, be it the rab to find the rabbi or see he's there, or what's next for him. then we usually cut at what he sees. This is the only the, and this also gives rhythm and the openings rhythm to the film, to because you have all the blurred background, but you have this tunnel, very very small tunnel
vision,
vision inside of that, and that is given, you know, by his quest. So everything that's linked to his quest gives the openings. Might be a goal to the POV of the character, or an editing point. And then usually he goes back to his own POV, mm-hmm, because he's still caught in the craziness of it. So that's the strategy we had to design beforehand, and that we also designed during the shoot to accomplish that.
How immersed were the actors? I mean, okay, he was a non-actor, the others are actors. How immersed were they in the story, as it were? I mean, in the knowledge of what was going on, of the characters they were playing. How much did you rehearse? How much did you talk? How much did they read?
I made them read a lot of things. Yeah. Based on their commando testimonies and everything they did it, and they worked. I said, you're gonna work, and they like working. I mean, I had the chance to work with actors who like working, which is great for given the Eastern European, you know, tradition of not working, at least in Hungary, I can say for that. Actors do not work and are lazy. And but a lot of them appreciate, you know, when they, you know, you have to work, you know, okay. So beforehand, and then and I had a tremendous good experience with Polish actors in this film who are really very much prepared, and this Hungarian Romanian guy from Transylvania, he was also very much into, you know, trying to grab the core of it. And and then we had 5 days of rehearsal, something like that. I wanted rehearsal in the crematorium complex. That's why I wanted also to have the main set being in one piece, so you could go from one subset to another, mm-hmm, for the, you know, you could follow them, you could feel the space around you and the logic of it. And you didn't have to cut because you went out of the crematorium or things like that. We didn't have to cut. We wanted to keep it one continuous set. And I think it helped them to be in the middle of it, to feel the weight of it. When you were in down underground, where there was the gas chamber, undressing room complex, it was very very heavy to be there. You could feel, you know, the weight of it. There was no light, and only artificial light, and you were there in a sense. So it was, I think it helped us help them, mm-hmm, to immerse themselves in this very, you know, very direct experience. And obviously when, you know, in the rehearsals helped us to define the shots, but also to define the beats in the scene, mm-hmm, how you work with that. But then and then some actors had, you know, problems not having to play act, you know, some kind of emotion, mm-hmm, that, mm-hmm, they projected. Which is normal. I mean, how do you deal with that? You know, or some kind of post-war emotion to their roles. How do you do that?
So again, restraint. We are again talking restraint,
and that's what I and they were very much into restraining themselves, and we worked together. Obviously, I know there were some frustrations. Some German actors and some other Hungarian actors, maybe, and some other actors. Well, you know, it's natural to always give more, but we had this feeling that I had this very, you know, basic feeling that I shouldn't let this happen, because we didn't want to, in a sense, create filmic emotion or you know, the traditional this body is around me and I have to, you know, take the children from the gas chamber and burn them. These guys in 44 were robots. They were not. They were killed inside, in a sense. And obviously, that's also a question. How do you know the humanity still stays? But these were inimaginable circumstances and very hard to project, to recreate in the film. So everything we could do is have a more, like, a very low-key approach to just bring the acting down as much as possible. And then the question was, how do you cope with that when you have a language that you don't speak to speak in the film? For example, Yiddish was spoken in the film, throughout the film, by people who didn't speak Yiddish, a lot of them. And how do you do that? So it's it. And how do you manage your voice? You know, how do you? We had incredible dialogue coach in Yiddish from Israel, who worked with them very hard. So the language preparation, and also, you know, they had to lose weight. Obviously, they were not like usual in image in this concentration camp imagery. Only bones, because there were Zonder commando members
who were better fed.
Better fed, they could take food from the transports, but still they were too big. And so the German actor who plays Biederman, he's still big, but he had to lose like 20 kilos.
My God,
you lost
23.5.
and He's still in good shape now. So thank me. But actually, that made, and Geza, the main character, the main lead, he had to lose also almost 20 kilos. And actually, it makes people nervous. It makes the actors nervous. So it's. I'm sorry?
So what?
Eat vegetables, but also I know that the lead would go to the, you know, in secret eat some chocolate, and I thought that I didn't see that he was eating chocolate and some other desserts, and
which is
not good. I mean, and he was very nervous, but I had to find ways to direct this frustration coming from food, which is a very basic thing, to use it, you know. It just and then you have all this manipulation of the actors and the fights and the tension, and just, it's interesting, just an anecdote that you're here to address it. But you know, in the script, the main Saul and Abraham, this played by this gentleman, are friends from before, in the first version, and then in the second version, and then we had the casting going on, and these guys met in Budapest, and the first day they almost had a fight. I mean, they almost had a
real,
you know,
fight,
a fist fight. and it created an incredible tension. Actually, we had to use this tension. I'm not revealing. I shouldn't reveal that to you when you're here.
That's not safe.
Well, it's okay. I think he knows everything. But you had to use this tension because, you know, these guys would never be friends in a billion years. These two men would never be friends. So how do you do that? So it's kind of transformed that into. In this set of circumstances, they're the closest that you can get. But it actually creates a tension between them, which is interesting, because he's close to him, but at the same time, you can feel there's something off. And you had, during the shoot, to work with them, not addressing this issue directly, but in a very kind of director's manipulative way to keep that tension alive, but at the same time not getting it out of control, because these guys, let me tell you, are you know, tough cookies. So it was it was interesting to work with this, you know, the frustrations of the actors, the tension between the actors, the languages, you know, because not everybody could, you know, the guy who plays the rabbi in the Sonderkommando, he was Polish, he didn't speak any other language than Polish and Yiddish, he's an actor in the Yiddish theater. So, but all these separations created tensions, and the fact that these were all strangers, even the strangers who have to be one family. And that, yeah, well, in a sense, they had to rely on each other. So, but we didn't want to expose this as a normal film. You would go and have a tremendous scene on, you know, how these guys are, can count on each other and saving each other's life. And this was not the film.
It's not the truth either.
Yeah, it's not the truth.
The question is, in that sense, then you also changed something in the script because of the former acquaintance between the two, the lead character and him, so that they are not friends, but you do leave at the end kind of, you don't have a child, you don't have a son, so we assume that they know each other
but
from before.
It's from the start,
it's interesting that tension.
How the casting process can
influence
the, that's good, that's why you it's good to start casting early. And you know, no producer ever understand why you have to do casting early, but it's good because you it can feed your screenplay and inform your screenplay and change it.
And Clara, so you were there also in order to change and adopt certain things
on the set, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was there.
But the question is whether you still adopted certain things.
Yes. And I remember writing, I think it was it the last day of the shooting, writing a scene the day before. No, writing a bit of dialogue.
Writing a bit of dialogue
because
very
we needed
strict about these things.
No, but that's true. He's right.
No, it's me
because I'm. Anyways, I was on set, but I was most of the time it was not to adapt or because that was already out of my hands. You know, it was their job. It was rather to check that everything that was in the book was, you know.
Actually, we had a very bad continuity.
So I did that. I was a part of a script girl.
Okay.
I liked.
Well, actually, no, but he was controlling because we had to constantly, there were so many little details that I know in film there are a lot of details, but in this you have all these languages and the you know, and there are a lot of very few references to what's going on around them, so we had to be very careful about that and what they would say each other.
Mm-hmm. So I was checking the dialogues mainly. So I had my little cask. That was nice.
Okay, and another very important element in this film is, of course, the sound. So the work with the sound, I think that creates something for the imagination of the viewer, creates that what we don't see, perhaps.
Yeah, it gives you more. It gives you a reference. It gives you more. It gives that impression of being in the middle of much more than what you can see. But we worked a lot on the sound and what it required in post-production was human voices. Mm-hmm. Constantly having all these languages and human voices and orders and whispers but you have to have them and you have to write them, and the most interesting thing was that my editor said with the editing that this film is gonna be written until the subtitles. And we actually had experienced that until before submitting the print to Cannes, we were still writing, determining what kind of off-screen lines would make it not to the sound, because we have all kinds of sounds and all kinds of dialogues and lines coming in from off stage, but to the subtitles. Because you have, you know, seven languages in a film, what do you subtitle? What do you omit? What's your strategy? So it was a very long process, and it was interesting to see that, for example, the fact that people go into the crematorium, and off screen, when Saul comes out, that several times during the film, and you can hear the voices by the German guards saying, you know, hot tea will, you know, is expecting you, and just go to the showers, and it actually, we put these lines quite late in the
off sound,
in the sound, but then we didn't subtitle them. But then we asked ourselves, and the editor asked, you know, why shouldn't we put it back and should put subtitle it, because that's something that's constantly going on. So you put an emphasis, by subtitling it, you put an emphasis on the fact that there's continuously a machine going on. And if you don't do that, then there's one layer
missing.
That's kind of missing. So it's interesting to how much time we needed, and the dialogue, and the dialogue list in I don't know how many languages, and the it's so complex that I should be called a bureaucrat by now, because it's incredible to amount of languages and information to. And what do you keep? You wanted to say something about that?
I just wanted to add, I mean, the very beginning, when you have this translated, really, you know, the routine, you know, and you undress, and then the hot soup, and it will get cold, etc., etc. That set for me out absolutely the routine and the understanding, the grasping of the tiny details. And I think that this fact that you went in for those so-called trivial details, this is what gets us very much near, mm-hmm. instead of indeed what you said, you know, the big historical facts, the big myth and everything. At least for me, I remember that when I saw it, you know, that said immediately, yes, I'm not there, none of us can be there, but yes, that pulls me in completely.
That was something that was on set. That was one of the monologues that was on set. So there was a guy saying this monologue, mm-hmm. He was walking around and saying the monologue. Whereas, for example, the lines with the coffee and hot tea, that's something that we recorded in post-production. After. I asked our friends in Berlin to send us real German lines by soldiers. So.
Can you talk about the sound process, the making of the sound and the decisions, how realistic, how not realistic, etc.? And again, the eliminations probably also there.
The sound is very instinctive, you know, in a sense. We put so much sound, we ended up with so much sound that at one point we said, oh, this is too much. And we had to take out a lot, and that's what happened, because there was an overwhelming amount of sound, and it kind of killed the audience. Mm. We didn't want the audience to be killed, just to get punched. That's enough. The killing is too much. So my sound designer, with whom we had three short films made, I went to see him before the film, and I took him on location, you know, 6 months before, just to have him check, you know, where we can use direct sound. And I said, you know, this film is at least 50% sound. And we did three short films together, and he was laughing. He said, yeah, okay, whatever, sure. And And then this, that was payback time. When in the post-production, after 5 months, I was totally tired, but he was tired as well. But he still had this feeling of maintaining, you know, to have this restraint at the same time. So we needed restraint also that in that manner. Mm-hmm. So it, because it gives you, because there are human voices, but there are, you know, and practical sounds and the machinery, and you have some music coming in from the, you know, the office or some external things, but always a very complex world being suggested by these sounds. I think the sound designer could be more specific about all these issues, but for me it was very, very, very instinctive the way I worked the sound. It was like composing. It's funny because we worked together with him, and I stay every day out there. Even when he edits and, you know, all the boring stuff, that's the thing I really enjoy. And because then I don't have to be in the middle of, you know, a crew of 90 and 300 extras, which is scary. And then in the sound, then we compose. It's really like a musical score in that.
But
we wanted to be very realistic, so.
But the decision, I mean, you know, the strategy of the sound. This is something which you formulated, I'm sure.
But I never, not in a conscious way.
No.
Not in a conscious way. I think I need time to process it.
But it was clear. I mean, first of all, you knew that the sound would be very important.
Yeah, we didn't have much. I mean, we did have the direct sound of the dialogues and maybe some sounds of the. Of the, you know, closing the door, things like that. But we had to recreate like 70% of the sound of the film. Had to be recreated, and the cries and the shouts and the orders and everything that we. The more we worked, the more we saw that it needed more human voices and orders. Mm-hmm.
Were you trying to be realistic, or were you trying to avoid being realistic?
Oh no, we were trying to be. There's a good example for that. How do you do with the 12-minute agony of people in the gas chamber, that you know, by all accounts, were, you know, could be heard
outside,
hundreds of meters away? How do you do that? And how don't you kill your audiences with a constant shouts and cries? Then it's an interesting question. So I think it's also an idea by my editor that, you know, every time that he goes closer to the gas chamber and there's a killing process in it, then you should hear something briefly. So in this sense, there's a part of subjectivity in the sound. It's just like it comes in just for it touches his ears and maybe some his conscience for just a split second, and then it goes away. Mm-hmm. So it probably is a sort of very limited. In time, very limited, you know, impact. Yeah, very, very surgical, and on him, because 99% of the time he's not aware of that anymore. But it's a constant reminder in the sense of the mission he has to do. So maybe that's something that he didn't have access to before. You know, it's just so closed, and then. So it's very unconscious in with me.
Mm-hmm. Questions also about the sound and the framing, the issue of the camera, which I think both are very, very essential to this film. I mean, I'm sure you noticed it while watching it. Any questions as to the decisions and the strategy and or the ethical part of the decision making? Yes.
Sir. Just a second. So with this film, I thought, I mean, you involve very long shots. So what I thought, I mean, it's essential, I guess, one of the essential elements is Saul's, the way he moves. So the choreography of the entire scene. So my question is basically, how much did you have to work on this? I guess location was a big part of it, obviously, and the way it was framed. So how much did it involve? How much energy did it take to frame it in this sort of way?
To set up the scenes or to...
Yeah, so to choreograph, in a sense, Shao, through the scene.
Yeah, there's, well, a lot of energy. It's, but it's good for the actors. It's good for everybody on the set to have this kind of continuous take. Because that's what not why we did it, but it's very good for the actors and the extras and everybody, because they're actually in the middle of it. You know, the civilians are scared, and they were scared. We had, you know, gunshots when needed. It was on set. You know, it was, people were really scared, not to scare them, but because it was the way it was. You know, so just sometimes we had shots, and I think we what we wanted to do was not to, in it's interesting, not to make a film around around the Shaul, the main character, in the sense we are obviously, but our approach was to establish everything that surrounded him before. We wanted to, that's why we wanted to have the research, you know, very, very precisely. What would people do at this moment? How many people would work on, because it's also a continuum of scenes, so you knew that at what point do the people go in, what point do we already have people undressing, or are they, some of their commando members taking off the clothes? How does it work exactly? And then when we established everything that was working in the time frame of the film and of the scenes, then we had to put the work processes. So how many Zonder commando members, how much stuff, how many guards and things like that, and then how much supervision, and then we put Shaul in the middle of it, and then he had to go from one point to the next, and then we put the camera on and we followed him. The question was more or less from behind or from...
No, it's like if from, it was...
No, I mean, my question was at that point from behind or from... Because we're basically constantly in a close-up. And how does it go with the previous shot? You know, where do you end? Where do you start? And we... I think we... The crew was very good and was used to establishing this kind of, because I also picked people who know how to make this kind of film, and the focus puller, you know, it's not easy to find someone who can do that, and everybody was on the same page, and yeah, what
the choreography, I mean,
I mean, so
yeah, we never wanted iconic pictures. It's funny because you cannot, it's hard to take pictures still out of the film. We, you know, word sales asked us a lot of times to take pictures out of the film. It's really hard to take more than three or four because there's no iconic, in the sense, there's no iconic moment. We didn't want this kind of iconic moment of you know, well composed. So it's there, you know, you cannot have something disgusting because otherwise, you know, it's just not interesting. It also just, it's you lose the audience in a sense. But at the same time, we wanted this, you know, these little accidents to happen, and a lot of people were not professional actors, so there was uncertainty, and I kind of kept this uncertainty also. So from one shot to the next, you might have changes, and the main character being very hardly controllable, and the camera being stuck to him. It always gave us something different, a little different. I'm not saying that it's tremendously different, but different.
So that means that your DOP had to be very alert.
Yeah, he had to. He always says that he had to have a dance with the Geza. It was a dance. And around Geza there were five people constantly. And for the DOP it was kind of dangerous. Sometimes he had to run, So it was very, very complicated, very harsh to, physically very, very complicated, but the physicality of it actually helped us also with the energy of the scene. So it helped us in that way.
Any other issues coming up from either the cinematography, those decisions, the role of the sound, how the sound worked for you?
Or just directing?
Kidding.
Just directing.
I have a question just about the choice of the lead actor.
What were the chief characteristics that you found in Geza that made you choose a non-professional?
Yeah, because we were talking about not having a professional actor at some point. You know perfectly that he helped me prepare a film in France. It was supposed to be a French film at some point, and we had a French actor attached to it, or we wanted to attach a French actor. And then I moved the project back to Hungary, and not willing to shoot this film in France. I wanted to shoot in Hungary, but no French producer wanted to shoot this film in Hungary. So I recalibrated this film to be Hungarian, and then I wanted to attach another professional actor. And he could have been very nice, but I think that the more we did the casting and the more we thought about it in the film, the more it became obvious that you couldn't have this kind of film actor attitude. Mm-hmm. Because it was the story of a simple man. It shouldn't be a hero. Saul is a lame guy. He's not very. He's always a little late, and he's always a little off and lost. But at the same time, not. I know, but he has this sometimes is this silent movie kind of character of being lost in the, and what I was looking for was a person who was Shaw already. And that's where I thought of Geza,
he's a lame guy.
He is a mixture of lameness and precision. He is instinctive and very intellectual. He's ugly and beautiful at the same time, and he is old and young at the same time, and
obsessive.
What?
Obsessive
and unbearable and sweet and very obsessive.
Yeah.
And very obsessive, and we wanted someone who already, I know it's cliche, but we wanted someone it was already like that, otherwise. And then how do you deal with the rest of the cast, how do you mix non-actors and actors, how do you do that? That's also an issue, how don't they start acting in a completely different fashion. So that was also something that
to harmonize them.
How do you harmonize the process? So it's something that I think we did it instinctively, acting actors being brought down to a low key level, them understanding, being brought in the process and certainly manipulated, but at the same time being explained, like human beings. I like people who are human beings before being actors, with whom I can have a relationship. But it's
same goes with the director.
And same goes with the director at some point. And it's funny that I still kept some distance with the actors. I didn't want to go too much into their soul, mm-hmm. because I needed a distance with them.
Your distance from them, so that.
With Urs, the German actor, I very very con. I don't know very consciously, but I very strongly kept him at bay. Mm-hmm. You know, I was kind of harsh with him. He's a former soldier from special forces in the German army, and he playing a, you know, playing a Jew, and still until then he was always playing like Nazi soldiers or whatever. And he was and for everybody we had an approach of trying to not to go too much into their souls. I don't know. I don't have enough experience to say whether I would continue. But for this project, I think it seemed right to not to go too much into them. But sometimes you have to find a way to
be sure that they don't ask you too much. What do I feel now?
That's it. Yeah, they just don't feel anything. That's it. Yeah.
And why do I do this?
Yeah. Why? Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Why do I do that? I don't understand. And why don't I act here like we're...
You wanted to avoid that, to be on the safe side.
I didn't want their eyes to be... their eyes to be too...
Expressive.
I wanted them to be lost a little bit.
Mm-hmm. That's to keep their...
Yeah, it's a fine balance between being reassured and being lost. Mm-hmm. Did you feel that?
I don't want to ruin your ideas about dealing with actors.
He's an actor. He's
yes,
an actor.
I felt it. Yeah.
It's again Hungarian irony,
yeah.
And cynicism. Yes.
From Transylvania.
Transylvania, yes.
She's
I
from
can
Transylvania.
I have one question for the script writing, script development, yes. That how much did you have to fight for your own freedom during these years of the script development? Were there any approach to push more, I don't know, from producers, co-producers or funds to push more, I don't know, motives or more happy end into the story, but you didn't want to.
First of all, I know co-producer, I know film fund, apart from the Hungarian film fund, because nobody wanted to co-produce the film. So nobody talking about the script to me. Apart from the Hungarian film fund, they were embracing it, they were trying to help, but embracing it. So no pressure. No pressure, apart from ourselves and the constant doubt and the...
I remember pages flying around the room. No, I'm not happy!
Thanks for revealing that.
Okay, then
in first place, congratulations on your great job and for the prize received at the Cannes festivals. I admire very much your courage to challenge the established model of representing the Holocaust. And I read in an interview that you refer to L.M. Klimov's cult film, Come and to See. Please add something about this, because I think that the reference is very visible in your film. Thank you.
It's an absolute masterpiece, obviously, and that's the best war movie I've ever seen, by far. And I showed it to Clara, and it had a great impact on her, I guess. And what the thing was, it's also a journey, and it's a journey with the boy, and it's very organic. Sometimes it's over the top, but it's fine. We didn't want to go into that domain of, you know, baroque representation of, you know, Bosch painting kind of thing. But at the same time, we had, he is very restricted, but at the same time, he just goes, you know, overflows. I cannot really put words on it, apart from this very organic approach, how you follow the boy throughout this journey. And it's something that very much affected me. Also the way you convey information, you know, how you restrain yourself, refrain yourself from not overusing dialogue, and the design of acting, you know, the directing the actor not necessarily in the overflowing moments, but in some intermediate moments, and the frame and the colors and the sound that's obsessed, it's obsessive, you know, and there is there constantly humming in your ear, and it's I think it's very, very far, but at the same time it's very near, the film. And the kid at the end is also, in a way, I think, an influence from this film. This kid running in the woods, something that represented the outside world, but I think I have him from the Klimov movie in a sense.
So I just want, yeah, there are more questions? If not, I'll add kind of first something from my own. Confession, as I told you already in Jerusalem, there was a closed screening of the film, and I was personally reluctant to go and see it. I was afraid. I was really afraid because probably having seen too many Holocaust movies, both fictional and documentary, and I wasn't up to the experience. And although László tried to tell me that it's probably, and he tried, that it's probably not exactly what I'm expecting, but I kept to my reluctance. And so finally I saw it here. So I must admit that it, for me personally, and I'm immersed in this subject matter, believe me, I know almost all the images that exist so far and that are known. I think it's this film, I think in its daring and in its courage and in its zooming in on an individual is a milestone in the fictional representation of the Holocaust. And when I came out of the screening here, there was an Israeli director with me, and Tom Shuval. And Tom said, you know, this couldn't have been made by an Israeli. And I said, why? We had a two-hour conversation afterwards about the film. And he said, because we are too much educated and not to mention perhaps brainwashed in this historic, mythical, you know, large scale, not daring to go for the one, the private, the individual, the detail, which is the only thing which probably can in some way touch us, in some way get near to us. I don't think understand that it's comprehensible, because I still think that everything is incomprehensible, which has to do with this, if we call it subject matter or period in history. But the detail is probably the only thing, and the individual is probably the only thing we can in some way relate to. And both of you, I think, succeeded in a big way.